Hey, Eli from Elfbane, and it's time to go over Sunday's game. Sunday's game came around a little sooner than I thought. Awesome. Thought we were going to have to wait till after the holidays, but turns out kids were ready, and, well, most of them, and we were able to get together and run the second session, long overdue, for the Sanctuary of the Serpent Sorcerer. When we had last left our heroes, they had defeated four serpent constructs that had risen from the floor of the snake-filled throne room of the sanctuary. My daughter's tiefling character, Genasi character, had been left unconscious and down from the experience. Kind of picking up right there. Afterwards, they had, without taking time to heal the Genasi warlock, and you'll have to excuse me, I'm not super keen on the character names here, so I'm going to refer to them by class. So the warlock is down, and so they are in a large throne room. There are spiral staircases in the far corners. There are large statues of serpent-headed humanoid guardians in the corners of the wall behind them, and there is a dais ahead of them with a big ornate serpent-themed throne and two large stone serpents kind of coiling up from the wall, similar to what they had run into in the original gate room after the long serpent coiling hallway. So, seeing that they also had a room full of snakes to deal with, the snakes seemed pretty placid at this point after having been beaten down as, as the snake constructs. They were just going about their snake business. I mean, they weren't really much of a threat unless you got in too close to them or stepped on them. So the Goliath and the Dragonborn, which is our ranger and our barbarian, took the large sharpened poles that they had taken from the supply wagon before they entered and started sweeping the snakes aside, clearing a path to the altar. So they get up to the altar and they realize that the altar is made out of gold and that and other precious materials, the scales of the big snake sculptures that are flanking the throne are worked jade, and the eyes of the prominent snake figure in the throne are two dark black pearls. This proves too much for the Goliath Ranger and the Dragonborn Barbarian to pass up, and so they start picking at them. Excuse me. So trying to recover these precious items, the Dragonborn is trying to chip off jade scales, and the Goliath is trying to remove the black pearls from the eyes of the snake figure on the throne. A hail of arrows breaks out from above. They had noticed earlier that there was a balcony above, and that's certainly where the two spiral staircases seemed to lead, but as there didn't seem to be any threat from above while they were fighting the serpent constructs, they hadn't paid it much mind. So arrows start hailing down. They realize that there are skeletal archers in the balcony above, and so they take cover behind the stone structures. The Goliath begins to fire back with her crossbow. And there is another crossbow in the party, which was the crossbow wielded by the warlock, which is picked up by the absent bard, also a Genasi, but she could not make it. So we were kind of ghosting her character a bit, using her when it was necessary, but really not playing her. So two crossbows to retaliate against a group of skeletons in the balcony above. They're doing pretty well. There's a few volleys back and forth. The combat goes back and forth a bit. The Dragonborn goes down, and so now it's just the Goliath. During the combat, the fighter, the human fighter in the group, played by my nephew, had bolted to one of the spiral staircases and started heading up. He was hoping to get a different vantage point or possibly be able to find a way to engage the skeletons in melee. Proved a little more difficult because he gets up there and found that the balconies on the other side of the room that the spiral staircases had led to were not directly connected to the main balcony that stretched across the entirety of the room. And so his only way to go was into another room and deeper into the dungeon. So he had poked his head in there, seen that there was a chewed corpse in there, fresh corpse. One of the corpse, in fact, the corpse of one of those poor, unfortunate wretches, those dungeon criminals that had been sent into the sanctuary before them, and who had all perished within 20 minutes. If you remember in the first recap, they had noted and kind of wondered where the corpses of those men had been. They had not seen any of them while entering through the main passage to deep into the center of the sanctuary, and so Edward, which is the name of the human fighter, he decides that this must be one of those. So he comes back out, and he calls down below for everybody to come up. So the Goliath picks up the Genasi and the Dragonborn, and being covered by the ghosted, a ghost played bard, they make their way up the stairs. Now, they had seen that there were two other ways out of the main throne room. There were two other sets of double doors, a giant vaulted bronze doors, but this seemed the most obvious way to escape up. And so they proceed up into the upper chamber. So what they find in the upper chamber looks to be kind of a study or something like that, and they kind of poke around, and then they managed to come around. Now, by this point, just to kind of note, they had managed to defeat the last of the skeletons. It turns out there were five of them up there, and they managed to dispatch them before they in the running fight to get up there. So you get up there, and they're looking through what looks to be some sort of a living chamber, study sort of a thing, sanctuary, kind of a inner sanctum. They're looking around, they poke around a bit. And they run into kind of a strange creature. It looks like a priest, but the it is gaunt and kind of ancient looking, and looks to be a hybridization of snake and man. And so they're fighting this thing. They fight it a bit, and it ends up they end up taking it down pretty quick. They got the jump on it. So there's some exploring that goes on. They look around through the balcony. They go to the other side that the skeletons have been on. It crosses across the main throne room, and they're able to go to the other side. They find a long hallway there with a more prominent statue at the end. This statue appears to be not of a guard wearing a human guard wearing a serpent themed set of armor, ancient armor, but it instead has a very snakish head. He's wearing much more detailed armor over that snake head. He's got a very ornate helmet, not a headdress, but a helmet, and before him he's holding this big bipennis, broad axe, very ancient styled. Most of this temple is themed very Bronze Age. And so they're picking up on that. The skeletons were wearing bronze armor. Their swords were bronze. The only iron that they seem to have on them were on the tips of their arrows. So this is a very ancient temple, or the sanctuary is very ancient. They decide they're going to pay that statue a little bit of respect and give it some distance. So the players don't go anywhere near it. They do investigate the other platform from the other spiral staircase, nothing of note there, but they did see a very ornate gold door carved with runes depicting similar scenes to that which they've seen throughout the rest of the sanctuary. this being, sorry, it's my cat trying to get into the garage behind me. But the door shows, you know, snakes and snake gods and worshippers, and there are some arcane runes there. And so they take some time. By now they had actually they had paused in the chamber after defeating the serpent creature before to do a short rest and heal up. So they're all the party are now up and running, and so they're looking over the door. The warlock, who is a warlock and has some experience with magic, rules and determines, well, she cannot read the script. She identifies that there are some magical elements to it. So they, at this point, they go to, they're going to ignore the door. They decide that they're going to really let the door go. All warnings, as far as the rest of the party is concerned, say, stay away. It's an important door. They can come back to it later. They're really only in here to reconnoiter the sanctuary. That was the deal with the lord in the lion armor. He didn't say anything about clearing it. He just said, look around, see what you find, and report back. And so this goes on a bit. And the dragonborn, though, is a little too eager. He decides that he is going to try and chip away some of the gold to the door. And at that point, these two, the runes in the door light up. These two coiling serpents of energy form and strike out at him, inflicting, a jolt of electrical energy and a searing pain. He can take some damage. So at that point, they pull him away, and they, you know, kind of backtrack back down the stairs that they had come up, and decide that they're going to go through one of the side doors, the double doors. So they head off to the left and push open the doors, and they find their kind of another chamber, a couple of rooms where they check some stuff. They do bump into a couple more skeleton guards. Nothing too impressive. I mean, it's a bit of a, you know, it's an old temple, and you know, there's certainly going to be, like any dungeon, there's going to be some nuisance encounters and the like. So they manage to, you know, they're going pretty well. They're exploring, they're checking, they're making sure that they're not advancing too quickly. So they as they move down the main hall that's there, they're checking shelves and looking, you know, all throughout this place. Seeing as it's an old temple complex, they're finding jars and cases and stuff. And so they are really trying to move through, but carefully. As they come to this larger room, they hear some noises, kind of a wet slurping noise, and they slowly creep up and they see another one of those serpent human hybrid creatures in the garb of a priest, laying, kind of languishing on one of these ancient decrepit lounge chairs, scooping the brains out of another one of those unfortunate victims that had been sent in before them. So at this point, we do some checks. Creature doesn't know that they're there, so they get ready. And it was kind of a fun, almost, for me, it was almost a very amusing Ghostbuster-y kind of a moment. As they get there, and they all simultaneously unleash their attacks. Dragonborn is throwing a javelin. The two crossbow folks the Goliath is using a crossbow. The warlock is using Eldritch Bolt, and the bard is using the warlock's crossbow. Edward, the human fighter, is standing ready. He's covering their back, and ready to defend if need be. So they unleash and they do a bunch of damage to this thing, and make their presence known, and I describe, you know, and so the creature, you know, screams and, you know, massive shriek, and flies from, you know, from its position of just laying there, springs, you know, cat-like to the wall and clutches onto the wall of this large, looks like, kind of like a reception hall. Yeah, and this is kind of where it gets kind of Ghostbusters, because the whole party's like, blah, you know, kind of freaked out. And then we roll initiative. They get initiative on the creature and absolutely just flub every attack after that. So, and you know, the creature, you know, having been dealt a pretty damaging initial volley of attacks, and seeing that they all missed, and, you know, clearly terrified by the experience of seeing this thing go from laying back to flying onto the wall, the creature takes advantage and disappears in down the passage to the south, through a door. So the party at this point is kind of taken aback, but the Goliath Ranger. Actually outdoes the barbarian this time in being impetuous and charges after the creature, not wanting to let it get away, and busts through the door to the south, being giant kin, not too hard, you're huge, and so runs into the passage on the other side, which is lined with skeleton warriors, all decked out in ancient bronze armor with shields and swords, and they all kind of just turn and, with a hollow, you know, hissing shriek, identify that they've seen her, and just pile into the Goliath. And the Goliath's at the door, and just, you know, about four of the skeletons manage to just slam up against her, and they're just slashing and clamoring at her. As I rolled horribly, so, you know, they're doing very minimal damage. At that point, the rest of the party comes up, hearing the fight, pulls forward and tries to lend assistance. The dragonborn barbarian pulls up and forms a line next to the Goliath, so now they're both fighting them off, while the warlock and the human fighter are trying to pull the Goliath back. Basically, they're trying to do a fighting retreat until they can figure out just how many skeletons are there. Battle ensues. They cut their way through the creatures, and they take a couple of licks and they take a moment. At this point, they decide that they are going to rest. They had negotiated for an extra day, so they have a full 2 days to explore. They've been in the sanctuary for a few hours, and so they certainly have time. And so they take a long rest. They secure the door that the Goliath had gone through. They're using the lounge, which has plenty of chairs and tables and chaises. They're all in states of disrepair, but they can form a barricade to the open passage that they came through. They're all going to rest and kind of chill out. During the time that they're resting, they leave the human fighter to stand guard, because he's the only one who really didn't take any damage, hadn't taken a lot of damage up to this point. After their rest, they're refreshed. While they're uprooting all of the furniture, they did find a box with some. They did find some coinage in there. There had been a hidden stash of coins, and so then they proceed. Moving down through the passages back to where they had fought the skeletons, they're a little cautious because they don't know where the hybrid priest had gone. And when they'd been cutting these things open, like in the previous priest that they had encountered, they just were just full of like black ichor and just, you know, didn't look like living flesh in there, and so they're a bit cautious. So moving through, they go into another chamber. It's a temple sanctuary complex, so there's lots of little chambers off in it. They come into this other room, and curiously, there's really nothing there. And so they're looking around, and the only thing that of real note is this massive tapestry on one wall. And this tapestry is very different from some of the depictions they've seen. All the depictions in the rest of the sanctuary have been very foreboding. Giant serpents devouring men, processions of snake human hybrids and priests and all of this doing very dark sacrificial rites and the like. But this particular tapestry shows the valley, the little mountain valley that the sanctuary is in. The sanctuary itself is depicted there. All the same familiar characters from the carvings and the like further at the temple are still there. But in this depiction, it's all bright and well-lit and sunny and colorful. And the snakes and the hybrids and the humans all seem to be coexisting in some sort of paradise-like depiction. This difference is picked up on by most of the party, so it's pretty cool. And so they decide that something must be special about the tapestry. Nothing else in here seems to be interesting. It's all a bunch of old jars full of ancient potions and or oils and incense and the like that have all gone spoiled. The Dragonborn has been collecting inks and the like for whatever reason he feels that they might be useful. But that's his character. So in their examination of the tapestry, they don't really see much of anything. They're trying to figure it out. Dragonborn is barbarian. He's growing impatient. Clearly, there's some talk about taking the tapestry. So he decides, well, if we're gonna take it, let's just take it. So he pulls it off the wall, and he fails a dex check. And I describe and so the rest of the party is standing there as the tapestry falls over the Dragonborn's head, but as it falls, it ends up laying flat on the floor. No impression of the Dragonborn beneath. So we cut away to the Dragonborn for a moment. He appears in another room, having in a moment just kind of changed positions, changed his point in space. And he's in another room, and there are four like ancient withered husks in similar garb, similar priest's garb, but lower ranked kind of like acolyte garb, that turn and raise these wicked forked daggers at him and leap to attack him. So he ends up having to go through about a round of combat before the party can act, because it's kind of all simultaneous action to when he pulled the thing off. So the rest of the party is like, where did the Dragonborn go? So they're lifting up the tapestry, and they're looking through it, looking around, and then they notice motion, some sort of distortion, some sort of motion in a part of the tapestry, and they realize that through the part of the tapestry that depicts the entrance to the sanctuary, they can see glimpses of the Dragonborn fighting these undead acolytes on the other side. He's and so they're like, what are we seeing? Clearly there's some sort of magic going on. And so the Goliath has the idea of sticking her hand through and wiggling it around, on the other side. And the Dragonborn sees it come through the tapestry and wiggle through. And he yells to them for help. And so at that point, they leap of faith. They just, one at a time, push themselves through that apparent portal in the tapestry. And they all pop up in the other room. The party makes short work of the now that the party's there in whole, they make short work of these undead acolytes. They beat them quite easily. And at this point, we were at the end of the day. I mean, it took them that long to get to that point in the dungeon, in the sanctuary. But it was fun. I mean, we had some kind of puzzles. We had some, they're trying to figure out what was going on with the tapestry. It was a fun session. We had some interesting character development. So the Dragonborn, his player, initially it was a point of frustration for the rest of the party, but I think, and to his credit, in the extent, we're talking about middle schoolers here, middle schoolers, and I think the oldest kid in the group is my nephew who's in high school. He's like, I think he's a freshman, so freshman or sophomore. So this the Dragonborns player decides, well, I'm a dragon. What do dragons do? They sit on heaps of treasure. So collectively, they're now just calling his insistence on trying to grab any piece of treasure to the point where it's caused some arguments between the party and him, because, well, as they're finding cool stuff, and I may have missed a few bits and pieces that they had found along the way, but as they're finding cool stuff, he's wanting to fight over it. And so they're calling it dragon greed. He's got dragon greed. It's something deep in his heritage as a dragonborn has him craving treasure, which is cool. I can get behind that. The Goliath is being played by my wife, who is a longtime D&D player as well. Not as she doesn't play as often as I do. She doesn't game as often as I do, but she enjoys it when she can. She's been trying to kind of pull back as playing her Goliath, which because she doesn't want to take over the game. So that's been an interesting experience. Unfortunately, we were down one player, and like I mentioned earlier, the Bard's player couldn't be there, and my daughter is recovering from a procedure on her foot, so she was a bit out of it as well. So she wasn't 100% on playing her character as well. But she hit all the keynotes, a little bit of prodding here and there, kept it together. But yeah, we had a good time, and so they're now deep into the sanctuary. They're not quite sure where they are because, well, they're on the other side of the tapestry portal, so they could be anywhere in the sanctuary. They did realize that they had were able to do to intuit some of the geometry of the sanctuary, in that upper level that they had been in was a very small second tier of the sanctuary. So they're pretty sure that most of what they've run in they need to explore is in that lower section. So we'll see where they go. We're actually doing we've decided to make the Sunday game every 2 weeks, because there are kids involved, and three of them aren't mine. Need to leave them some time for family and other obligations. So made a little bit more sense. It says also going to be beneficial to me because it will mean that I'm not going to be every week doing two back-to-back games. I will be doing a recap for my Monday night game. That's the Mal Morgan's Ledger adventure. And so look out for that one. But yes, so this has been session two of my Sunday game. First adventure, they're going through the Sanctuary of the Serpent Sorcerer. Stay tuned for more, and thanks for checking out Elfbait. Keep on spreading the word. I've noticed a couple of new subscribers, and see if we can get more questions and answers going through there. If there's videos for other stuff that you'd like me to do that are not adventure recap related, by all means, put them in the comments below, and I'll definitely get those made. But yeah, so have a good one. This is Eli, and get out and game.